CPU, computers, people, and understanding. The series where we take you, the viewer, through everything you need to know about your home PC. Now, over the last few episodes, we've been getting an awful lot of mail in, and we've got an awful lot of questions to answer. So we've gone through our lists of most frequently asked questions, and we're going to cover them tonight. I'm Rob Farr.
And I'm Sean Banky. A lot of those questions deal with various parts, such as with viruses, the internet, different components, the different computer languages that are out there. Also, a bit of tweaking with Windows 95, some of the hints and tips that you may or may not know about the wonderful operating system.
All right, well, we're just going to get right into the questions now. The first question comes from a viewer named Stephen. And Stephen asks, can I catch a virus by looking at a web page? Well, Stephen, no, you can't. Now, if you look at if you download a certain program or programs from unreputable websites, those programs may contain viruses. The best thing to do is stay to the more mainstream web pages that have a name to uphold. Now, most of the files from these sites will be virus-free.
Now, our next question comes from Kathy, and the question that she has to ask is about the internet in a certain language called Java. Her question is simply, what is Java? Well, Java is a language that has been developed by Sun Microsystems, which allows worldwide web pages to contain code that is executed by a browser. Now, because Java is based on a single virtual machine that allows versions of Java to emulate, it's possible for Java programs to run on any system which has a version of Java. It is also possible for the virtual machine emulator to make sure that Java programs downloaded through the web do not attempt to do unauthorized things. Actually, Java can be used in the absence of the web, but the application has sparked so much interest in Java. Oh, sorry, actually, the main part that has sparked so much interest because of Java is called Hot Java, a web browser written in Java language. You can learn more about Java and Hot Java off the Sun's Hot Java homepage, which is http://java.sun.com.
All right, well, the next question we have is from Mark. Mark has a question about audio CDs and his CD-ROM in his computer. Now, his question is, apparently, when you insert an audio CD into the CD-ROM, it'll start playing automatically. Now, his doesn't. And what is he missing? Well, the first thing is, Mark, is that you'll have to check to see whether you've installed the drivers for your CD either from a CD-ROM or from floppy disks. Now, if you've installed from a CD-ROM, okay, you're going to have the audio drivers or the player itself will automatically start up, okay? Now, if you've installed from diskettes, it doesn't enable this function, all right? Now, another thing that you can check, okay, is to go to your control panel if you're running Windows 95 and select System, and then select System Properties, okay, and then select your CD-ROM. Now, double-click on your CD-ROM and select the settings for it, okay? Now, in the settings, there should be a box with a selection saying Auto Insert Notification. If you check this off, every time you put a music CD in your system, it should automatically come up and start playing.
Now, our next question deals with Windows 95, and it comes from Tony. Actually, his question is, how do you switch the Windows 95 desktop if you have another program such as Word or Maximized? Well, you can do that simply by one or two things. Your desktop is actually still there, other vice versa. Your desktop can simply be covering up your other program, or, for instance, I have on here WordPad, which is simply covering up my desktop. Now, there's two different settings you can have for this. Now, for the one setting, as you notice, I have no taskbar at the bottom. Now, to simply access that, I can hit Control Escape, and it will automatically bring my taskbar forward. As you can see, it has the Word document, the WordPad in the taskbar, and I can select that if it was minimized. And of course, if you want to switch back and forth between different programs, you can hit Alt and tab, and that will flip back and forth between if I had multiple programs running. Now, for instance, I'll load up a simple program such as Paint. Now, while that's loading, I'll maximize that, and if I hit Control Escape, it will bring up my control bar and show me what programs I have running. But if I wanted to switch back and forth between the two, I can hit Alt Tab, and it will bring up a main window showing me all the programs that I have running. If I want to switch back to Notepad or whatever program I'm actually using, I let go, and boom, there it is. It's simply you're cycling your way through the different programs that are already loaded on your Windows 95 desktop.
All right, now our next question is from Mike. And Mike has a question about the internet and the pictures on the internet. Now his question is, which format is better for World Wide Web images, JPEG or GIF? Well, this is a question that is raging in amongst the computer industry. It really depends on what type of picture you're trying to view. Now, if you're trying to view a photograph, a JPEG, or a Joint Photographic Experts Group format picture is better to look at. If you're looking at a line art images, like a company logo, or just an icon or something like that, a GIF is better to go with. Now, a GIF has limitations as to the number of colors that you're able to see, okay? You're limited to 256 colors, okay? With a JPEG, okay, you get a better representation of the actual picture, but if you were to take that picture and edit it, and you do that frequently, you'll lose quality of the picture, okay? If you're going to be working with photographs off the internet, it's best to save them in a TIFF format or a PNG format. Now, a PNG is a Photoshop graphic. Now, if you want to learn more about GIFs and JPEGs, you can find more information on the internet.
Our next question comes from John. His question is I'm having trouble getting DOS CD-ROM games, which need 590 plus K of conventional memory, to run into Windows 95. What can I do to allow them to run? Well, this question kind of deals with DOS 6.2.2. Now, if you have upgraded Windows 95 and had DOS 6.2.2 on your machine previously, this is where MemMaker is. It was one of the programs included with DOS 6.2.2. Now, when you upgrade with Windows 95, what happens with that is it actually becomes a secondary operating system. This is what's commonly known as a dual boot system. Now, the way you can find out if you have a dual boot system is if when you first turn on your computer and you come to the secondary screen that has the brief summary of what your computer is, if you hit the F8 key, you should get what's called the Windows 95 startup menu. Now, there are some third-party programs that allow you to have this menu come up all the time. Now, the feature that you're looking for should be the eighth option, which has a command line that says previous version of DOS. Now, this is probably the best way to run your MS-DOS based games, is in its own true operating system. Now, what you do is you simply hit the 8 and it will load up whatever autoexec and config.sys you had in your previous version of DOS. Now, in that one, you can simply type MEM and it will give you how much conventional memory you have. Now, as I mentioned, if you don't have enough conventional memory, simply run your MemMaker program. Now, the MemMaker program will scan your autoexec config.sys and see what programs you have running, and it will ask you to reboot. The thing is if you don't have Windows 95 menu that pops up automatically, you have to get ready to hit F8 afterwards, or you will miss the MemMaker cycle. After you do that, MemMaker should go through and find out and free up some conventional memory. There are some third-party programs that do this better or help this conventional memory problem along, but you have to remember when you are running MS-DOS based games or DOS games, it is better to run them in their true environment. If the game itself says it can run in Windows 95, you can do it with what's called the DOS shell. But as you remember, depending on the type of game, it is better to run it in its native format.
All right, our next question is from Barry. Now, Barry has a question about Windows 95 and the recycling bin. His question is, How do you avoid the file delete confirmation in Windows 95? Right now, whenever he deletes, it asks him for confirmation to send it to the recycling bin, and it's getting very annoying. Well, Barry, the reason why that confirmation is there is to make sure that you know which files you're going to be deleting off of your hard drive. Now, if you delete files by accident, okay, if you turn this confirmation off and you delete files that you didn't mean to delete, they're gone and you can't get them back. Okay, this confirmation may be annoying, but it does ask you to confirm if you know exactly what you're going to be deleting. Now, the way to get rid of this, okay, is to go into your Windows 95 and go to your recycling bin. Now, you move your cursor or your pointer over top of the recycling bin icon and you right-click, okay? Now, by right-clicking, that brings up your menu and it says the properties at the bottom here, okay? So you want to select properties, okay? Now, that brings up the recycling bin properties window. And you have the global tag here, okay? Now, the global tag will say, it gives you many different options for the recycling bin. It says here, do not move the files to the recycling bin, remove the files immediately on delete. Now, this is very dangerous. If you don't know which files you want to delete, or if you're just deleting a whole bunch of files and you accidentally delete an important file, it's a good idea never to have this selected. Now right here is what we're looking for. It says the display delete confirmation dialog, and it has a check mark in the box. So what we want to do is just left click on that box and it gets rid of that particular selection. Now whenever you go to throw something in the recycling bin, it won't do that display delete confirmation. We'll just click on the apply button, okay, and then we'll just click on OK. And it's all done.
We're going to take a short break right now, but be sure to join us in the second half of the show where we'll have plenty more of your questions to answer.
CPU is sponsored by BT Video Productions and Computers, located at 140 Highway Street in Petawawa. Phone 687-5198.
And welcome back. We're going to continue right along with our frequently asked questions. Our next question comes from Chantel. Her question is, can I use the internet as a telephone? Well, yes. In recent months, several programs have become available that allow you to use your computer as a telephone. Now, the three things that you need in order to use your computer as a telephone are a proper internet connection, special software, and a voice-capable modem. Now, this allows you, with these three components integrated with your system, this allows you to use a voice in real time over the internet. In effect, using the network as a telephone. Now, some of the programs are available free off the internet. Now, most of the time when you get your modem, your voice-capable modem, it will come with software. You can also buy commercial software that will do this, but most of the people like getting on the net and trying out the different free software. Most of these products are ready for prime time, although some of them are in their infancy and are still in their experimental phase. Some of the programs that are available are Speak Freely, which is available at www.formillab.ch/netphone. That's netphone/windows/speak_freely.html. Another one is See You, See Me, which requires a video camera to be hooked up to your camera. It's available at cu-cme.cornell.edu.
All right, our next question comes from Larry. And Larry has a question about SCSI devices. He says, what is FastSCSI? Okay, well, there's SCSI and then there's FastSCSI. Now, SCSI stands for Small Computers Systems Interface. It's a type of hard drive interface that you can hook hard drives, CD-ROMs, scanners, and so on. You can hook up to 7 devices up in a SCSI chain. Now, with regular SCSI, you have transfer rates, okay, of upwards of 1.5 megabytes per second. Now, that's accomplished by what's called an asynchronous transfer. Now, asynchronous, to put it into layman's terms, for every request of data that you have one acknowledgement, okay? And like I said, you can have up to 1.5 megabytes per second of transfer rate, and upwards of 5 megabytes per second of synchronous transfer. Now, synchronous transfer, okay, allows you to have multiple requests, up to 3, per every acknowledgement. Now, that speeds up everything much faster. Now, regular SCSI works on asynchronous, okay? For every request, there's an acknowledgement. Fast SCSI works on the synchronous, where you have multiple requests, but only one acknowledgement. Now, the term fast is generally applied to a SCSI device that can do synchronous transfers of speeds of excess of 5 megabytes per second, okay? Now, it can only be applied to SCSI 2 devices, okay? SCSI 2 is your asynchronous transfer, since SCSI 1, which is the synchronous transfer, didn't have the timing margins that allow for fast transfers.
Our next question comes from Jason. His question is, why is SCSI more expensive than IDE? The main reason that SCSI costs such much more than IDE has to do with production volume. There are approximately 120,000 hard drives made in the world today. 85% of those drives are IDE. The remainder of those are SCSI and other such strange devices. The actual percentage that are SCSI drives are falling at a very slow rate. Without the production volume, the component products remain high, and since that's why you pay the extra price. Another reason is also for the host adapter. Now, if you take the average cost of an IDE adapter, which happens to be $15, compared to that of an average SCSI adapter, which is $50, you can see the price comparison there. Also, if you're looking for higher quality, you're looking to spend anywhere between $100 to $500 for a SCSI adapter, whether it be a normal SCSI or a SCSI wide. Now, if you figure a way how to get more people to buy SCSI hard drives, say, average of 50,000 a day, that would probably bring the SCSI hard drive prices down to that of the standard IDE. But until you actually figure out a way to do that, with the way the IDE hard drives are expanding in capacity as well as speed, it may be kind of hard thing to do.
Now, our next question comes from Mitch, and Mitch is asking about recordable CDs and regular CDs. Now, his question are recordable CD-ROMs identical to normal CDs? And can I use recordable CD-ROM drive to copy my CDs? Well, Mitch, yes, the recordable CDs and the regular CDs are identical in size, okay? They can both hold the same amount of information. Now, recordable CDs, however, okay, are burned in using a laser. The information is put on with a laser, and quite often those CDs will be either a green color, gold, or a blue color, whereas the CDs that you buy from the store pre-pressed are actually pressed like a vinyl record used to be from a master mold, okay? Now, these CDs that come from the store, obviously, are silver in color. They're your standard CDs. Now, bear in mind, okay, that most CDs are protected by copyright law, okay? You can make copies of your software for archival purposes or backup purposes, all right? But the same does not necessarily hold true with music CDs.
Our next question comes from Angela. She's wondering, how do computer viruses work? Well, first of all, Angela, you have to remember that there are many different types of viruses. Some of the viruses can be malicious, or they can be just as sent out as a practical joke. The two viruses that I'm going to cover are a file virus and a boot sector virus. Now, a file virus attaches itself to a file, usually an executable application, for instance, a word processor or a DOS program. In general, file viruses don't necessarily damage or infect data files. However, data files can contain embedded executable code such as macros, which may be used by a virus or Trojan writer. The other one I was mentioning is a boot sector virus. Boot sector viruses alter the program that is first in the first sector of your hard drive, which is known as the boot sector, of every DOS formatted disk. Generally, a boot sector infector executes its own code, which usually infects the boot sector of a hard disk or floppy disk. If you were to put a floppy disk into your computer that your hard drive has been infected, that floppy too will be infected unless it has the right protect on.
Okay, now the next question is from Andrew. And Andrew's question is, what is the year 2000 problem? All right, well, when computers first came out, the BIOS chip, okay, which is the chip that controls your time and your date and your year setting, okay, it was programmed in what was called COBOL programming language, all right? Now, when it was first programmed, these chips, the BIOS software, was never designed to go past the year 2000, okay? It was only to go up as far as 99. They omitted the first two numbers of the year, okay, the 19. Now, what will happen is in the year 2000, all the computers that still have this old code will reset, and the computers will think it's the year 1900 as opposed to the year 2000. Okay, now some computer programmers have been very, very busy lately trying to reprogram or make new BIOS chips that will switch over to the year 2000. Now, the problem with this is, say with a bank or with any kind of financial transactions, you'll have a lot of checks that will be all of a sudden out of date when the new century turns around.
Our final question comes from Brian. He's wondering is, what is overclocking and what chips can be overclocked? Well, first of all, overclocking is a slang term and not an actual engineering or scientific term. What overclocking is simply increasing the clock rate of the processor beyond its actual stamped rating. The purpose of actually overclocking a CPU is quite simple. It saves you money. Say, for instance, you were to take a Pentium class 100 megahertz CPU. You can probably set that setting on your motherboard and overclock it to the next step, say a Pentium 120. Now, what you're really doing is sending more instructions through the CPU, which causes a lot of heat. Now, what people do when they do overclock these chips is they have to add a bigger fan, which cools down the system, cools down the chip even more. This is more or less of a hacking thing. If you feel comfortable doing this yourself, by all means, you can do it, but it's not normally recommended overclocking your CPU. If you simply want to get more speed out of your computer, wait until the proper CPU comes out that you feel the speed is comfortable for you, then buy it. Don't go out and overclock your computer system.
All right. Now, in this episode, we've taken some of the more common questions that we've received from our viewers and taken time to answer them. We've covered a varying range of topics, all the way from MS-DOS through to Windows 95, the internet, and some hardware questions. Now, in future episodes, we're going to be concentrating on the Windows 95 operating system, as well as some advanced DOS features.
Yeah, that's right, Rob. We'll be dealing with a little more the complexity of Windows 95. Now, we've shown you the basics of the start button, the taskbar, how to create shortcuts, how to manipulate the files using your control panel. We've also shown you how to select multiple files by simply dragging and dropping. We'll be getting into the more advanced features of the Windows 95. A lot to deal with the properties, how to actually use your right mouse button, and a lot of the programs throughout Windows 95, because it is a multitasking operating system. But as you mentioned before, the DOS features, we're getting a little more in the DOS, where DOS still really does play a big part in today's operating systems.
That's right. Now, we've covered some of the basic DOS, but we're also going to be covering some more advanced DOS, as well as some potentially damaging programs that are included with DOS that could potentially mess up your hard drive quite badly if you don't know how to use them properly. So we're going to be showing you how to use those programs. Well, keep those letters and keep those questions coming in, because in future episodes we're going to have more frequently asked questions. For CPU, I'm Rob Farr.
And I'm Sean Bankey. Thanks for joining us.